In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made through Him, and without Him nothing was made. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory. Welcome to Living Word Baptist Church, where the Word of God comes alive. Our mission is to exalt the Savior, equip the saint, evangelize the sinner, and empower the community. Our pastor and first lady are Reginald and Vanessa Fletcher. Please enjoy this recording of a portion of one of our Sunday morning services, and stay tuned at the end for general information about our exciting ministry and how you can get involved. Now, let's enter in and be blessed.
Praise God, praise God, praise God. I am just in awe of my Father, because from the beginning of this month to today, God has done some mighty things in this house. So I thank and I praise God. To God be the glory. So a couple of months ago, we put out this long flyer of everything that was going on, and y'all probably was like, oh my God, all of that? But how God has worked in and out of through people and through lives and through families, I just thank and I praise God. And then just to finish it up with that song that Beautiful Feet just done, we need to be a tree planted by the living water, not a dead tree. We need to be alive in Jesus Christ. So I'm excited and I am so honored to stand before you today to introduce our speaker on today. And I was going to run through all this, but I'm not going to do that. You know what? Elnora Daniels has been here before, and she is a child of God. She's a mother. She's a grandmother. I asked her what her job title was. She is the one in HR that hires for IPS. But guess what? She's a child of God. And so even as she runs through her message on today, she's hiring today. She wants us to be children of the Most High God. And she's going to tell you some characteristics and some things you need to do so that you are prepared, because one day we're going to meet our Maker. So I stand to present to you Minister Elnora Daniels from the Messiah Missionary Baptist Church, where Pastor Clay is the shepherd there. And Elnora has sat under Pastor Clay, and you've heard him preach the word, so you know she's prepared to preach. After the choir, we'll hear none other than Minister Elnora Daniels.
Hallelujah. the Lord.
Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord. And he went on to say, our God is risen. He's still alive. He won the victory. He reigns on high. Our God is risen. He's still alive. He won the victory. He reigns. He reigns. He reigns. He reigns. He reigns. Hallelujah. 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 We ain't gonna get along. We ain't gonna get along. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. What a blessing. What a blessing. What a blessing. What a blessing. So sweet spirit in this place. It's the presence of the Lord. From Sister Locke. God bless you. 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 Well, I got notes this morning. God bless you. To the sister who wrote the poetry and the young girl's dance, God bless you. God bless you. To Pastor Fletcher. Bless you, Pastor Fletcher. Thank you so much for the invite and the invitation to be here. Thank you for being such a good friend to my pastor. Pastor Stephen J. Clay, senior pastor of the Messiah Baptist Church. That's my pastor's good friend over there. I love how they have stayed friends all these years. I bless God for that. So we just bless God for the man of God of this house, though. God bless you. Just for what he's allowed to happen in this month of celebration for the women of this church, an opportunity to grow and to develop, to be challenged, to be confronted, and to be changed, to be transformed by the word. We bless God for that. We bless God for that. So Sister Vanessa, God bless you, sister. Just love your spirit. Thank you, Vanessa. Thank you for being available to the Lord. So to the people of this great church, thank you so much for just for being here today. It's Memorial Day weekend. I know folk got grilling on their mind. So, but we ain't gonna be long, so you can all get to it, and me too. All right, all right, all right. So let's pray, and then, oh, I want to just, to my friends, let me not forget my friends that came out this morning to support me. Thank you. Thank you. They called and had prayer with me, and it's just sweet to have them here. I appreciate their presence on this morning. Amen. We're going to pray and we're going to move right on into the word. Father, we bless you. We thank you. We honor you. We love you for this time, this place, for this hour, for this moment. We thank you for your word because we know your word is true. Your word is a light to our path. It's a lamp unto our feet. You said it won't return unto you void. It will go forth and it will accomplish the purpose for which you sent it. Thank you, God. That your word is sharper than any two-edged sword. Thank you, God. That the same word that cuts heals. Thank you for your word, God. So I just pray now that the words of my mouth, Father, and the meditations of my heart will be acceptable in your sight. Because, God, you are my strength and you are my redeemer. In Jesus' name that we pray, amen. Amen, amen, amen. So if you would, I'm going to segue just a little bit from your theme text today, and I want to take a look over at 1 Samuel chapter 16 and the verse is 7. If you've got it, you stand to your feet for the reading of the Word of God. For God sees, not as man sees. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. Then turn with me over into Acts chapter 13, and the verse is 22. Amen. After removing Saul, he made David their king. God testified concerning him, "I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will do everything I want him to do." You may be seated. Matters of the heart. If we want to live and thrive naturally in these bodies that we have, we need to be heart healthy. Healthy diets, healthy habits, and so it is in the spiritual. If we want to live and thrive spiritually, we need healthy hearts. Because whatever is in our hearts affects and infects every aspect of our lives and the lives of those connected to us. The Word of God in Luke chapter 6 informs us that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. If it's in there, it's coming out. You're still cussing people out because it's in your heart. I know you didn't mean to say it. You don't know where it came from. Wish you hadn't said it, but you said it because it's in there. That's why we have to hide his word in our hearts so we won't sin against him. And so the writer of Proverbs tells us, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. And I'm here to tell you that we need to keep our hearts under 24-hour surveillance. You ought to call ADT or Guardian Protection because your heart needs surveillance. Because there's a thief and a robber, and he's trying to get in to your heart. See, the enemy wants access because he knows if he can access your heart, he can cause some heart trouble, create a heart condition. And every now and then, we have to do what the psalmist said and ask God to examine our hearts. Could see if the enemy has found a way in through an unlocked window or an open door. You ought to nudge somebody this morning and tell them you better check the windows. You better check the windows. Because what the enemy understands is if he can get in, everything is up for grabs. Because your heart is a storehouse of treasure. There's valuable stuff in your heart. Because the word says where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So the peace of God that passes all understanding will guard your heart and your mind. Peace is a treasure for somebody who can't sleep at night. You got to take Zoloft and Prozac to calm your nerves. Peace is a treasure. The enemy wants your treasure. The word says if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, you shall be saved. Your faith, your salvation, your belief is a treasure. It resides in your heart, and the enemy is coming after your treasure. And he's coming because he wants to rob you of your future, your destiny, the plan God has put in place for you before your mama had a pregnancy test. You were still a, I think I might be. And God was already ordering some stuff for you, putting in place for you a destiny. Now, 1 Samuel 16 and 7, the Lord tells the prophet Samuel, when he was in the process of identifying the man God had chosen for himself to be king. God had chosen for himself a king. And he said to Samuel when he got to Jesse's house, look, don't start tripping off the way folk look. Because y'all looking at the outward appearance. You don't see what I see. Because I'm looking at the heart. And what I know from scripture is that David had some awesome successes, but he also had some tremendous failures. Yet the Lord's testimony about David was that he was a man after my own heart. And I want you to know today that despite your missteps and your mistakes, God speaks well of you. He thinks well of you. Isaiah said the Lord delights in you. But I like the way the songwriter said it. He said, you thought I was worth saving. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. With my messed up self. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I could be whole, so I can tell everyone I know. Bless his name. So God has a plan. That plan is to conform us into his image so that we can have a heart like his. It's a plan to use us so that our lives matter. He said, for I know the plans I have for you. You are my workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works. The plan is God designed, is God ordered, is God destined, is God protected, is God sized. And it will surely be fulfilled in the life of the man or woman of whom God has declared. They have my heart in these matters. So I want to know what you have to do for God to testify that that's a man or woman after my heart. How do you get God to give you that kind of compliment recorded in the word for others to read when you know what your life has been? How do you get God to have that testimony about who you are? So I looked at David's life, and there's so much there, but I just wanted to talk about a few things today, just a few matters of the heart that I want us to glean from his life, from both his successes and his failures, the principles that are there. So I want to talk about a heart for family, a heart for forgiveness, and a heart to fight. We were formed for family. We were birthed into biological families. And when we were reborn, we became part of the family of God. God made us for relationship with him and with one another. It's in this context of family that you and I learn that we're developed, that our attitudes and the beliefs of our heart are oftentimes shaped. Many of the things that matter to us today are a direct result of family experiences. In family, we experience our first teachers. Yeah. Most time, it's our parents. Right. If we're blessed to have sisters and brothers, we learn from them how to get along with one another. Right. Not to hate on each other. Right. Not to beat up on each other. My mama didn't have that. She said, brothers and sisters don't fight. Right. You family. Right. Family don't fight. And I know that was born out of my mother's context, because she had two brothers who fought. Over a gun and a girl. One brother ended up dead and the other in prison. And so from her context, you don't do that. And I know she made up her mind, I'm gonna teach y'all, you don't fight one another. You support each other. You talk to each other. You stand with each other. But families are often flawed and fracture. We had flawed parents. They did the best they could, but now you have flawed children. Sometimes you got blended family situations with stepchildren, and if you aren't intentional about how you nurture and discipline and love those children, you'll create fractures in your house. I had a young lady share with me recently that her biological sisters were close, but they never included her. And she resented that for years. And said then she realized that resentment was shaping her adult relationships with other women. Wow. And she said, I had to go back and get that thing right with my sisters so that I can now have it right with my sisters. She had to ask God to help her fix that thing. So we get the first glimpse of the flaws and fractures in David's family when Samuel arrives on the scene to anoint him as the king. He don't know it's David, but we know it's David. In 1 Samuel 16:1, God has directed Samuel to get his oil, go down to Jesse's house, because I have chosen one of his sons to be the next king. And when we get to the scene, Samuel has, they've had the sacrifice, he's consecrated Jesse and 7 of his 8 sons. Samuel immediately thought the oldest son was the one God had chosen. See, he was well-educated. He was physically fit. He was tall and looking good. And the Lord said, no, not him. Then he brought in the second one, and the Lord said, no, not him. And then the third, and the fourth, and the fifth, and the sixth. And the Lord kept saying, no, not him. Can I just stop right here and tell somebody today, if the Lord has told you no, not him, no, not her, no, not now, you need to just keep it moving. Tell somebody, keep it moving. Keep it moving. Keep it moving. Keep it moving. Wait on the Lord and be of good courage, and he will strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. So Jesse brought before Samuel all of his sons but David. He didn't even invite David into the room. Now I want to know what you do when your own family treats you like you ain't good enough. You know, sometimes we expect hurtful things from other people. But you don't expect hurtful stuff from your own people. Not from your own family. Your own biological family. Your own church family. We ain't gonna get along. Amen. 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 Jesse's decision not to bring David into the room with the rest of his sons was a clear message that he didn't believe he could possibly be the one God had chosen. And Samuel asked him, are these all the sons you have? And Jesse said, well, they're the youngest, but he outside tending the sheep. I want you to listen. Not only did his father not invite him in, he didn't even call him by name. He didn't even say, my son David. He said, the youngest is out tending the sheep. I want to know what we do when our family decides that where you are is where you always going to be. What you have is all you ever going to have. And what you're doing is all you ever going to do. You ain't never going to do nothing but tend sheep. But I stopped by to tell somebody, you better not count me out too soon. Because God chooses the foolish things of the world to shame the wise, and the weak things of the world to shame the strong. I know you didn't expect me to do more, be more, have more than I have right now. But haven't you heard that the first will be last, and the last will be first? As a matter of fact, God will bring everything to a halt in the room. He told Samuel, go get him. As a matter of fact, we won't even sit down till he get in the room. And when David entered the room, the Lord said, anoint him
He's the one. He's the one. He's the one. He's the one. And today I want to tell somebody, you're the one. You're the one. You're the one in your family God has chosen to break generational curses. You're the one in your family to whom much has been given and now much is required. You are the last one in the room, but you'll be the first one out. The first one out of debt. The first one out of poverty. The first one out of college. The first one to teach. The first one to preach. The first one to get married before you have babies. The first one not to drink. The first one not to do drugs. The first. The last shall be first. I remember for a period of time thinking about the fact that all of my sisters, there's six of us, every one of us got pregnant before we had got married. We may have gotten married before we actually had the baby, but we all conceived before we were married. And I looked at my babies as a single parent. I said, Lord, it stops here. With the two you have given me, I'm believing you to break a generational curse. That will not be their testimony. They'll have a new thing to talk about. And so can I just tell you that my two single parent that I was, me and God raised them two babies. They got married and then they had babies. They got married and then they got master's degrees. And they got married and now I got one working on a PhD. The first. And I want to encourage somebody today. God has chosen you to be the first to do something in your family that ain't never been done by anybody else. You can have whatever God wants you to have. You can do whatever God wants you to do. And you can be whoever God wants you to be. Don't let the devil make you think you can't be all of that. You all that and some. Not cause of what you have on. Look, I say I was gonna sing the song. It's not the way you wear your hair. It's not the stylish clothes you wear. Woo! It's all about who Jesus is. Who he is in you. Because he's for you. He's on your side. He's on your side. He's on your side. And he has planted in you destiny. Destiny. Purpose. He's designed you to make a difference, not to just accept the norm. Change things in your family. You can do that. You can do that. You the one. You the one. You the one. David had a heart of forgiveness. He had a heart for forgiveness. He had a heart for forgiveness. After he was anointed by Samuel, the word records that the Spirit of God came powerfully upon David. In other words, David was strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Everything he would do in the strength of God. He would do what God yes. He'll do what a God yes. He didn't make moves without talking to God. David did the one thing that I practiced, I made it my business to practice it, and that's to keep a short list. Short list. Keep a short list. Short list of your wrongs. Keep a short list. Don't let nothing hang out there too long. Keep a short list before the Lord. He learned how to deal with matters of forgiveness quickly because unforgiveness is a major heart problem. It's a blessing blocker. It's a blessing blocker. It's a prayer killer. You may as well be talking to me about what you need if you got unforgiveness in your heart because God ain't going to hear you. It's major. It's major.
That's good. Yeah. Thank you, Lord.
It has killed or led to the death of friendships, the death of marriages, because folks couldn't get past some wrong, some hurt that could have been worked out.
the death of ministries because you mad at somebody in the church so you don't want to work with them to do ministry. The ministry dying on the vine because you decide I don't want to work with that sister. It's unforgiveness. And you may as well not expect anything from the Lord if you don't deal with that. It's an artery blocker. It'll cause heart disease. Do you understand that sometimes heart disease is just in the DNA? You doing all the right stuff, but because you done got it from your mama and her grandmama and her great, your great grandmama, because they didn't forgive nobody. Now you got heart disease, and it's killing families, and it's killing men and women. I told my girls, I said, the one thing I didn't do, I didn't talk bad about their daddy ever. Because at the end of the day, he was still their father. He was still their father. He ain't paying no child support, but he was still their father. And at the end of the day, what I didn't want for them was to take that mess into their own marriages. I didn't want them to arch that over the husbands that God was going to send them. If they didn't get it right, they were going to hold those men hostage to what their father did not do. It's wrong. And God gave them godly men. I prayed for them. I asked him, give my daughter some men who love Jesus and who will love them like Christ loved the church. And God did just what I asked him to do. Ooh. But I refuse to let unforgiveness rob me of the joy of serving Jesus. Unforgiveness, unforgiveness, unforgiveness. And oftentimes the greatest struggle is our ability to forgive our own selves. Ooh. Sometimes that's our greatest struggle. Because the enemy going to beat you up. I remember the first time somebody asked me to speak, and the enemy was talking to me, and he was saying, this is real. This is real conversation. Wow. What you going to tell somebody? What you got to tell anybody? You ain't got nothing to tell nobody. That's what the devil was telling me. Because you know what he wants you to do? He wants you to shut your mouth. I said, devil, you a lie. I am saved. I have been redeemed. I am not all that God wants me to be, but I am not who I used to be. And if the Lord give me an opportunity to tell somebody, I'm going to tell how he set me free. I'm going to tell it. I have to give this testimony because I do it every time this sister is in the room with me. But there's a sister here today, one of my good friends. That girl helped me learn how to drive, helped teach me how. She was my good friend. We spent a lot of evenings together, partaking of meals. We were in the same church family together. She spent a lot of time at her house with her family, a lot of time she spent in my home with her family. But then the enemy does what only he can do. He got in that thing. And we spent years not talking to one another. I told somebody I'd treat her like she was Casper the Friendly Ghost. She'd be at my parents' house. I'd walk right past her like I ain't see her. I made a point of going down that aisle because she was coming down this one. And as the Lord began to grow me and to challenge me in the places of my heart, he said, fix it. I said, why? I got to fix it. I ain't the one that messed it up. She tore it up. Watch yourself, man. Watch yourself. And what he told me for what I want to do in your life, for what I want to do through you and with you, fix it. Because I can't use you with unforgiveness in your heart. Anybody just want to be used by God to make a difference? Get that stuff right. Get it right. The testimony of our relationship in this house and how we love one another. It's a testimony to folk who are looking for a reason. When my pastor texted me this morning and said, El, the world is hungry for the living bread. Give them living bread. Living proof that you can forgive and go on. I'm so glad that God doesn't conceal the faults of the men and women in the Bible. He just lays it all out in his word so we can learn from it. So we can learn how to fall down and get on back up. Because a saint is just a sinner who fell down and got back up. So we can take our cue from David, who wrote Psalm 51 after what was probably one of his darkest hours. He unslept with Bathsheba. That was somebody else's wife. She got pregnant. And then he puts in place a plan to cover it up. The plan didn't work. Then he positioned the man to lose his life. And then he got called out by Nathan. But you know what our response would have been? And he called himself a Christian. Y'all know that's what we would have said about David. He said, whatever God said, he's after a man after his own heart. He called himself a Christian. Did you see? Did you hear what he did with that woman? We better watch what we said about God's people. But I love this about David. When his sin got called out, he didn't make excuses. He didn't make excuses. Well, you know, she was out there. No, he didn't go down. He said, I have sinned against God. He accepted responsibility. He went to the Lord. He acknowledged the condition of his heart. He asked for forgiveness. He accepted the forgiveness that God gave to him, and that freed him to be able to give it to somebody else. So his prayer to God is recorded in Psalm 51. I ain't gonna read the whole thing, but I'm gonna just read a little bit of what he said to the Lord. He said, have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Then he went on to say, cleanse me with hyssop and I will be clean. Wash me and I will be whiter than snow. For I know my transgressions and my sin is always before me. I'm having a hard time forgiving myself, God, because I see what I've done. Then he goes on and says, create in me a pure heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Then verse 17, he said, my sacrifice, oh God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. You, God, will not despise. And if we're going to be people after God's own heart, we're going to have to learn how to say, God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, God. I'm sorry I didn't lock the windows. That I gave the enemy easy access. As a matter of fact, I had the window wide open so he could come on in and steal, kill, and destroy. God, I'm sorry. I've been waiting on somebody to say I'm sorry to me. But I need to be the one to say, I'm sorry. Forgive me for waiting. Forgive me for the blessings I missed while I've been waiting on somebody to do what you called me to do. Forgive me for that, God. Somebody need to tell somebody, I'm sorry. And you know, I know it's true because I was trying to go a whole nother way with this message. And the Lord said, no. Somebody needs to tell somebody, I'm sorry. And then they need to tell me, God, I'm sorry. And then name why you sorry. Tell him why you sorry. Don't say, God, I'm sorry for the things I said and the things I did and the things I thought. No, God, I'm sorry because I've been gossiping. I'm sorry for being a liar. God, I'm sorry for robbing you of the tithe. God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that I've been killing relationships with my tongue. I'm sorry. Tell God why you're sorry. Be specific about why you're sorry. Don't tell me you're sorry and then when I, well, what are you sorry for? Ain't that what we do with our kids? Mama, I'm sorry. Well, why are you sorry, baby? What'd you do? I'm sorry because, I did break that. I tore it up. And we have torn up some stuff and we need to tell God that we're sorry. We owe God him, and I'm sorry. We owe God, God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I've been sitting on my gifts. I'm sorry, God, I haven't given you what I owe you. I haven't lifted up my hands yet today since they've been in the worship service. I'm tired, I don't feel like it. You owe God, God, I'm sorry. You put breath in my body, woke me up this morning. I owe you a praise. I owe you a lifted hand. I owe you, God. And I'm sorry for being so focused on myself. I couldn't give you what you do. God, I'm sorry. Then I have just one final thought, and then I'm done. David had a heart to fight. He had a heart to fight. And sometimes you got to fight to forgive yourself. Sometimes you got to fight for that family that's fractured and flawed. But you got to fight. I looked at David and I thought, well, you know, he was in a whole lot of battles. He was in a whole lot of battles. I mean, he fought some lions and bears. I said, oh my. He ran from some fights and he avoided some fights. And they were fights he could have won, but he avoided them anyway because it wasn't his fight to fight. And so we fight in battles sometimes that we don't need to fight, y'all. We fight in battles with people and we fighting just to be fighting. We fighting and we ain't winning. And then we fighting with the wrong weapons. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're not carnal. They're not born out of your flesh. But they are mighty through God. And he said, those weapons I've given you will pull down strongholds. You can tear some stuff down. But not if you're fighting with carnal weapons. So I looked over in 1 Samuel 30 where David and his men had been to war. And then they came home to Ziklag. And when they got there, wasn't nobody there. The whole, their home had been burned down. The enemy had taken everything, destroyed everything. And took everybody, the young and the old. They took them little praise dancers that was up here. The enemy came in and took them on out of here. Sister Locke, with her Exodus knowledge, oh, they took her too. Enemy came in and took everybody. And these men came back from war thinking they were coming home to be with by their families. You all right. It's all right. I like that. It's all right. It's all right. It's all right. They thought they were coming home to be embraced by the people they loved and the people who loved them, only to get there and everybody was gone. And scripture said they cried, and they cried till they couldn't cry no more. Can you imagine hundreds of men weeping, grieving over what had been taken from them? And then they got mad and said, shoot, we're going to stone David. You the leader. You took us out of here and we came back and now we have nothing. Well, David, he's grieving too because his wives are gone. His family's gone. But then the word of God said, while everybody else was grieving, David found strength in the Lord. He encouraged himself. The word in the original language is huzzak. David huzzaked himself. He pulled himself together and got a grip on his emotions. He took control over the meditations of his heart and said, Lord, should I fight? Do I go after them? Do I go get what's been taken from me? What would you have me do? And the Lord told him, yeah, go fight, David. And you're going to recover everything that has been taken. And I just want to tell somebody today that you need to go fight so you can recover everything that the devil stole. So God is going to give it back to you, but you got to fight. So I want to ask, what have you stopped fighting for? What are you too tired to fight for? Because you done got battle weary. Because you done said, Lord, I've been fighting this fight a long time. And I ain't won yet. What's taking you so long? Because my arms are tired. That's why you got sisters. Because when your arms get tired, guess what? They hold you up. Vanessa on one side. Reverend Fletcher's mama on the other side. Holding you up so you can stay in the fight. There is too much at stake to stop fighting. But you need to know when to fight. You need to know who to fight. And you need to know how to fight. Praise is a weapon. Praise is a weapon. Praise is a weapon. Your hallelujah. 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 God, I thank you. I thank you that my son is saved. I thank you that they're set free. I thank you that they're in the body of Christ. I thank you that they love Jesus. I thank you. Praise. It's a weapon. Prayer is a weapon. Put on your armor and get in the fight. And stop fighting with words. The power of life and death is in your tongue. We killing more than we giving life to. Out of our own mouths. The word said a foolish woman tears down her house with her own hands. You turn it down with your own mouth. Can I tell somebody to shut your mouth? If the Lord don't give you nothing to say, be quiet. Stop speaking out of turn. Stop speaking death where there ought to be life. That was my lesson. The Lord told me, shut up, Eleanor. You say nothing till I tell you what to say. If I don't give you nothing, I don't want you to say nothing. I was like, oh, God, because I always had something to say. I always had a comeback. What have you stopped praying about? Where have you thrown up your hands because it looks like too much? Like there's just no way for me to get through this. Ain't no way for me to get back all that I've lost. I'm just done. Stick a fork in me. I'm finished. Where have you stopped? Where have you not made room to show up for God to show up and fight for you?
Because some battles are not yours, they are his. Some battles are not yours to fight, they are the Lord's to fight. And he'll fight for you because he is the God of the angel armies. And he got a whole host of weapons that he can use on your behalf. So I want to encourage somebody today just to know that this matter of your heart really does matter. Your family matters. Get a heart for your family. Even when they wrong, it's your family. God has given that biological family to you and your church family. If you got sisters in this fellowship and stuff ain't right, get it right. You holding up the ministry of the church. Get out of God's way so he can do in the body what only he can do. And then learn how to give forgiveness and learn how to give it to your own self. And stop waiting for somebody to tell you I'm sorry. Be sorry you've been waiting. You be the one to say I'm sorry. And then get back in the fight. Don't give up on God, because he won't give up on you. He's able. He's able. God is able to do just what he said he would do. He's going to fulfill every promise to you. Don't you give up on God, because he won't give up on you. And we ought not give up on each other, because God is able. Amen. Amen. God bless you.
Amen, amen, amen. What a word, what a word, what a word. The doors of the church are open. You know what? After a word like that, everything in the house ought to fall on the altar. I mean everything, even the cockroaches ought to fall on their knees and give God some praise. Because every one of
us. Lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. Beloved, we are thankful, excited, and humbled that you decided to worship with us today. We pray this recording has been a blessing to you and that you are not the same person you were before you heard it. If you're interested in worshiping with us again, our normal Sunday morning service times begin with Sunday school for all ages starting at 9 a.m. And our Sunday morning worship and celebration begins at 10:15 a.m. We also have midweek Wednesday Bible study at two convenient times, either 12 noon or 6:30 p.m. For more information about our church and other ministries, please check out our website at www.lwbcindy.org. That's www.lwbcindy.org. Or friend us on Facebook or follow us on Twitter at LWBCINDY. Beloved, we just want you to know we love you. And remember, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. May God bless you and keep you.